Good morning. Welcome to the worship of God at the French Huguenot Church on this beautiful Sunday, which also happens to be Mother's Day. So for all the mothers, all those who have mothers, happy Mother's Day to you all. It is a glorious day to worship together, and we are thankful that you have chosen this place as your spot of worship on this day. If you are a long-time member or a first-time visitor, welcome. We are glad that you are here. If you are visiting with us, a special welcome to you. And we do ask for just one small favor. In the pew box where you sit is a small red book. Please open it up and fill out the information of who you are and where you have come from. We are not going to track you down. We're just curious where you've come from and how you got to this place. We are thankful that you are in this place this morning. Immediately following worship today, there is a tour of the church if anyone is interested. A member of our church will meet you right down here in front of the altar table and give you some great information about this place, who we are as Huguenots, and how we fit in within the Charleston community, not only now, but in the years past. And also, after worship, we will gather for collation at 44 Queen Street, a couple houses down up Queen Street. Wonderful time of fellowship with food, with drink, with good people around. So I hope that you will make it a point to stop by there after worship. If you would please also take a note of the other announcements that are in your worship guide for things that are happening later this month and ongoing. It would be good for the life of the church. This is a beautiful day that God has made, so it is good to worship together. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Worship continues on page 3 of our liturgies. Let us pray. O Almighty God and Heavenly Father, we have come together for the public sanctification of this Lord's Day to offer unto Thee our praises and our prayers and to hear Thy holy word. Thou hast promised to hearken favorably unto all those who call upon Thee in the name of Thy Son. We therefore beseech Thee to look down upon us in mercy and to purify our thoughts and affections that we may render unto Thee an acceptable service. Great God, we humble ourselves before Thee. We adore Thy majesty. We extol Thy wisdom, Thy power, and Thy goodness, which appear with such brightness in the marvelous works of creation and redemption. We acknowledge Thy tender love and the manifold favors, spiritual and temporal, which we continually receive at Thy hand. But we praise Thee more especially with all Christians who are assembled this day, that Thou didst send Thy Son into the world to save us, and that He rose from the dead for our justification. We bless Thee that Thou hast given us, by His glorious resurrection, so lively a hope of everlasting life. O God, Thy glory is great in all Thy churches, and the praise of Thy name is heard in all the assemblies of Thy saints. May our thanksgivings ascend unto Thy throne. Make us worthy to be partakers of the resurrection of the just, and of the glory of the kingdom of heaven, whither Jesus Christ hath entered as our forerunner, where He liveth and reigneth, where He is adored and glorified with Thee and the Holy Ghost, God blessed forever. Amen. Will you please stand as we sing together hymn number 230.
Thank you.
worship continues on page 5 of our liturgies. Hear with reverence the Ten Commandments of the law of God as they are written in the 20th chapter of the book of Exodus. God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, who brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, nor anything that is thy neighbor's. Hear also what our Lord Jesus Christ saith in the 22nd chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Dearly beloved, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us therefore humbly confess our sins. You may be seated. O Lord God, eternal and almighty Father, we confess before thy divine majesty that we are miserable sinners, born in corruption and iniquity, prone to evil, and of ourselves incapable of any good. We acknowledge that we transgress in various ways thy holy commandments, so that we draw down on ourselves, through thy righteous judgment, condemnation, and death. We are, O Lord, under heartfelt sorrow for having offended thee, and we implore thy grace to relieve our wretchedness. Vouchsafe, O most gracious God and merciful Father, to have compassion on us, in the name of thy Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Pardon our sins, give us the graces of the Holy Spirit, and increase them day by day, to the end that heartily acknowledging our unworthiness and forsaking our sins, we may be filled with that godly sorrow which worketh repentance unto salvation, and may bring forth fruits of righteousness acceptable to thee, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Happy Mother's Day. The first lesson will be from the readings of Galatians 5. I will be reading from the New International Version. Life by the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not be conceited, provoking and envying each other. Here endeth the first lesson. Second lesson will be from John 19. I'll also be reading from the New International Version. The Crucifixion of Jesus. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciples whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to his disciples, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciples took her into his home. Here endeth the second lesson.
Glory be to the Father.
Let thy mercy shine upon us. O God, make clean our hearts within us. O Lord God, we render thanks unto thee that thou hast called us to the knowledge and profession of the Christian faith. We beseech thee to preserve and increase it in us, to the end that continuing steadfast in the same, we may sincerely unite in the confession of the Church Universal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Ghost and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified. He died. He was buried. He went into the place of departed spirits. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost. I believe the Holy Church universal, the communion of saints, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. O Lord our God, Creator and Father of the human race, who has commanded that prayer and supplication be made for all humankind, we offer unto thee our intercessions for the peace of the world and for the happiness and salvation of all people. Deliver, we beseech thee, O Lord, from spiritual blindness all the nations that still sit in darkness. Thou didst so love the world that thou gavest thine only Son to die as a propitiation, not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. Thou hast taught us that he came to be a light unto the Gentiles, and to bring salvation unto the ends of the earth, and that there is none other name under heaven given among men and women whereby we may be saved. Grant, O Almighty God and merciful Father, that all your people may be gathered unto the name of our Lord, to the end that all nations may know and adore thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. O Lord, who art the source of all lawful power, and the fountain of all true wisdom in the counsels of your people, we pray to thee for all who are in authority throughout the world. Thou hast taught us in thy holy word that thou dost govern the nations upon earth, and that rulers should serve and obey thee. Vouchsafe then, O most mighty God, a knowledge of thyself to such as know thee not, and give thy grace unto all, that ruling in thy fear, they may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with thee. O God of mercy, have pity on all those who are suffering by war, pestilence, or any other scourge, and on all who are in affliction. We commend to thy care the widow and the orphan, the poor and the stranger, all who are in peril by land or by water or by air, all who endure persecution for the gospel, all who are distressed in mind, the infirm, the sick, and the dying. Comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, and give them a happy issue out of all their trials and afflictions. And Lord, as we have gathered in this place, we ask that you hear our silent prayers as we lift them up to you. Favorably hear us, O God. Graciously hear all who have at this time offered up their prayers unto thee. Reject not the supplications of thy servants, but grant us the blessings we have asked of thee and all others which are necessary for us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we offer up our prayers. Amen. Our sermon hymn is 225. Will you please stand as we sing together?
Thank you.
in his novel, Rabbit Run, John Updike talks about this young man named, nicknamed Rabbit, because he played basketball and that was how he ran up and down the basketball court. Rabbit got married young. He and his wife had a baby. He was trying to figure out life. And then his baby got sick and his baby died. And Updike paints the picture of him walking down the street to the church to attend his son's funeral. And he starts looking at things, even though he had lived in this little town all his life, seeing things like he had not seen before. And he says to himself as he's walking, why does anyone want to live here? Why is this ordinary town the center of the universe? And then he asked the question any one of us here this morning could ask ourselves, why am I me? What am I doing with my life? I'm grateful to many women that I've known over my years here on this earth. Some were birth mothers, some were not, but they were like mothers to me. And one of them was a teacher named Doris McCoy. And she introduced to me literature and inspired me to read and to think and to notice. She introduced me to the Danish theologian philosopher Kierkegaard, who's probably best known for what he said, to understand our lives, we have to look backwards, but we have to live forward. She has enriched my life over the years to ask questions of myself. Who am I? Why am I me? What am I doing with my life? In a few weeks, you will be seeing a new oil painting of Dr. Charles Stewart Vedder, who served this church for like 50 years. All we had was this black and white photo, and our artist friend Jennifer from Beaufort has turned it into a color, and we will be hanging it at 44 Queen Street. Dr. Vedder came here. He was born and reared in New York, came here from Somerville. He was here during the Civil War. This city was devastated by that war. I have read that there were people in the streets, mothers and children and widows, with no place to stay. So in 1867, two Snowden sisters met with Dr. Vedder in the same pews you're sitting in this morning, and they said, we've got to do something for these mothers. So Dr. Vedder encouraged them. They leased the building that is now known as the Confederate Home on Broad Street. They leased their home at 15 Church Street. And they and nine other women, they started providing a place for these homeless mothers and children. They had to ask this question of themselves. What can I do to help these unfortunate mothers and children and widows of this war? And about the same time, up in West Virginia, in Taylor County to be specific, there lived a woman named Ann Revis Jarvis. Her father was a Methodist minister there, and he had been transferred to the Appalachian. And her life was tied up in going to church, going to Sunday school, teaching Sunday school. But she saw what was going on there in that poor county she lived. She and her husband had like 12 children. Seven of them died at birth. Four of them lived. But she started something, seeing the problem was sanitation. The problem was health. So she started an organization with other mothers in Grafton, West Virginia, to improve health and sanitary conditions so that people could live a lot better. During the American Civil War, the sentiment in West Virginia was unlike here. West Virginia had left Virginia, and they were pro-Union. Virginia, of course, was pro-Confederate. So her Mother's Day work changed. She started serving the Union and the Confederate soldiers. She even had a prayer for the first Union soldier that was killed there in her county. As the war ended in 1865, she and the club members planned something called Mother's Friendship Day, trying to bring these people who were so sorely divided over the war together. She taught Sunday school at her father's church, Andrew's Methodist Church. And her daughter was there at the class when she taught it. And she said, "I just hope that one day mothers across America will be honored for what they've tried to do for their citizens, for their families." Ann Jarvis died in 1905. And on May the 10th, 1908, Anna Jarvis, who was then living in Philadelphia, remembered what her mother had said. And so she had a service at Andrew's Methodist Church, and then she had another service in Philadelphia that attracted like 15,000 people. Simply because someone asked, "What can I do? How can I make a difference in someone else's lives?" Mother's Day is a day that we look back. We look inside ourselves too, and we look forward. We ask, "Why am I me?" It's not a day that's on the church calendar. Some churches, some denominations, they do not even acknowledge that today is a day that is special to a lot of people, not only here in America, but around the world. But I have lived and I have recognized everyone wasn't as fortunate as I was to have a loving mother, or as David was. So we sometimes hesitate to go too heavy on Mother's Day. But a guy that I've been reading for a long time, Robert Fulghum, who was a Baptist who turned Unitarian, became a best-selling author, but he was a pastor for 25 years. And he said, "You know, I had a lot of freedom to preach whatever I wanted to. But on that second Sunday in May, I had several ladies said, 'Look, I'm bringing my mother to church Sunday, and you better preach on mother, and you better make it good.'" So he did. On Mother's Day weekend, 1976, I did what probably many of you did when, if your mother was living, you went to visit with her. You took her out to lunch. You may have even bought her a carnation or orchid or something. I was concerned about her. She was a mountain woman. My father had died 6 months before. I was the only child. So I left her on a Saturday. I went back to these little churches that I was serving. At the end of the service, I noticed that the sheriff was in the parking lot. And he said, "Something's happened to your mother, and you need to get back to Spartanburg." So I made the trip back, and I got there, and she had had a massive stroke. And all she said, and the last thing she said to me was, "You shouldn't have come back." I have not read the paper this morning, but I imagine there are things in there about mothers and grandmothers and aunts and uncles and those that have touched our lives. Several years ago, a guy that I've read through the years, Thomas Friedman, his economist, he penned a column for the New York Times entitled "Call Your Mother." And the reason he did that, his mother had just died. So he shared the story of Paul Bear Bryant, famous coach of Alabama, who had been hired by this telephone company to do a commercial, and his mother had recently died. It was a simple commercial. So Mr. Bryant went to the studio. Music was playing softly, and he said, "Call your mother. Call your mother." Thomas Friedman said, "I wished I could." Maybe some of us wonder just how we got to where we are today as people. As I look back on my life here in this church, I didn't know a soul, but I had Alice Gillyard, who became like a mother, and she'd say, "I just want you to be the best." I had Jane Mayla, who was much better educated than me and taught art history at Columbia for 40 years. But she became like a mother, even though she'd never had children. They took an interest in me. And no doubt you've had people in your life that have taken an interest in you, and it made you feel like you were loved. Life can only be understood backwards, but it's got to be lived forward. And to do that, you've got to look inside yourself and ask some questions. One of the great American writers of the last century was a man who had a pretty sad life. Alcohol got almost the best of him. But he came back and he met this other poet, and they married. Her name was Tess Gallagher. And in one of the books that they did, he simply said, "Tess, Tess, Tess." She published a book of his poems after his death. And one of them is called Late Fragment. And these are the words: "And did you get what you wanted in this life? Even so," he says, "I did. And what did you want? To call myself beloved. To feel myself beloved of the earth." You heard the lesson this morning. It showed the human side of Jesus. He looks down from the cross and he sees his mama. He sees his disciples. He sees an aunt. And he says to these disciples, "Look, take care of your mama." And so she went and lived with them for the rest of her life, according to the scripture. I don't know how many of you watched the NFL draft. Seemed like it was on every channel I turned on. And I remember hearing Roger Lovett, who was a pastor in the upstate years ago, and he preached a sermon on if I only had one sermon to preach. And he closed that sermon out with this story. And I thought of this story when I watched some of those African-American mothers with their sons who are going to the NFL. Her son was the best football player in the county. He'd gone to a prestigious college, and now he was being drafted in the NFL. And before he was to leave their little quaint house on a dirt road, she got up and fixed him breakfast. And then she hugged him. And she turned so that he could not see that she was crying. And he turned so that she could not see he was crying. And then she said something very profound to him. "Remember who you is. Remember who you is." When we look backward, we can live forward because we have looked at ourselves. Amen.
Sing, joyous Christians, sing for the Lord.
You are the people of God, having given your best to the Lord today through prayer, through song, and through word. May we all go from this place and be doers of the word and not hearers only. Go with God's love, go with God's grace, and go with God's peace.